And let's join together on this Easter Sunday morning and celebrate that Christ is risen.
My Lord. He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen. To think that those same words are being pronounced in churches all over this world, and as they have been for the last 2,000 years. Sounds good, Dave. Dave's excited. Are you excited? Happy Easter to you. I am here in my suit. I'm a Christmas and Easter Christian. I wear my suit on Christmas and Easter just to prove I can still fit into it. You're all looking lovely today. We're so glad that you're able to join us. Many of us came a little bit early today and had breakfast before church, sitting around tables, fellowshipping with one another. It was awesome. It was like, it's been so long since we could do this kind of thing, just hang out and have a meal together and catch up on what's going on in each other's lives. Thank you for being here today. Today is a special day because this is a day we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the worship team's been hard at work preparing to lead us today in a day which is a day of celebration. And I just encourage you to enter into that celebration together with them as they lead us now. As we begin the service, let's just open with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for the reality of the resurrection of Jesus. Thank you that we have friends around us, brothers and sisters in Christ, who together can lift our voices in praise and in honor to your name, for you are worthy of praise. Be with us now in this time of worship, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship together.
Please stand and join us as we sing.
The greatest day in history, death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the perfect peace, earthly pain finally we'll see. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day. King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross.
On. There we go. All right. This morning, I know what I want to talk to you about. I don't know if you noticed before the service, there was an advertisement, I guess, an announcement for a games night on Saturday the 30th, which is 2 weeks from now, I believe. It's 2 weeks from now. I invite all of you to come. Please come out. I'm going to be actually cooking if anybody wants to dare come beforehand. We're just going to have some chili, but please feel invited to have some chili. Come play some games with us. Now, some people... I don't know if it's still a thing these days, but some people used to think that church was not really the place we should be playing games. You know, we shouldn't be trying to fool people. We shouldn't be trying to lie or these kind of things. And I agree. But the games these days have changed so much. It's not so much about play acting as strategy or the mechanics of games. And it's different. And I really think that when you play games, you're really creating a sense of community. You're creating friendships, you're opening bonds, you're creating a relationship between people. And I think that's really what we're meant to do as Christians. We are to create relationships with other people. So we're going to try a games night. Now, games, God played games. Like in the very beginning, Genesis, Adam and Eve, you know, they figured, oh, we're naked. We got no clothes on, we should hide. And they hide. And God came to the garden, he's looking for him. He's, yo, Adam, Eve, all y'all oxen free. Where are you guys? You know, and they come out and it's like, well, we, you know, and he's, why are you hiding? Well, because we knew we didn't have any clothes. He said, it's okay, don't worry about it. But I think that, like, that's basically hide and seek. He was playing hide and seek. And ollie, ollie, oxen free. That's how I used to say it. It's supposed to be ollie, ollie, out in free. Ollie, or ollie, all outs and free. All outs and free, I guess. And that came into ollie, ollie, oxen free. And Jesus played the same game. Sure, when he was on the cross, he basically said, ollie, ollie, oxen free. Anybody out there who wants in, you're in free. There's no rules. There's no initiation fee. There's no nothing you got to do. All you got to do is just say, yeah, I want in. That's why he died on the cross for us. Because some of us, maybe all of us, I mean, I hope everybody in this room at least, has figured out that I want to be part of that. This is a real thing going on. Jesus came and died, and then God raised him up for us. And the one thing that Jesus said on Thursday has always stuck with me. It was his command on Thursday. He said, go out and love one another, just like I loved you. Love one another. And how can you love each other if you don't create relationships? So let's invite people in. Let's have them in and create those relationships. And if games is a way of doing it, I hope that's a great idea, and I hope you'll come out. If not, then please don't come out, but pray for those of us who do. All right? Let's pray right now. Father, thank you that really all you ask of us to do is love each other. And that's really an easy thing to do. I mean, sometimes we get upset, sometimes we get mad, and we scream and yell, but we can always say, I'm sorry. And especially to you. We can always say we're sorry to you, and we know that you forgive us because Jesus died for us. He forgave us for everything. Thank you so much for that, Father. It's an amazing gift your Son gave us. May we truly recognize how special we are. Amen.
Thank you, Dave. At this point, we'll allow our children to go out to their classes. Pastor Sergio with the younger children and Dave with the teenagers. You're welcome just to go to the back. Fran, are you a teenager? Wow. All right. Will you just bow with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather and worship and for the songs that we have expressed this morning that express our devotion to you and the celebration of the truth of Easter. We ask your blessing upon the tithes and offerings that people have left on their way in today that enable us to continue to minister here among this congregation and in this community and around the world. God, we just pray that you would bless it and use it and help us to discern the best way to use that to impact our community. And Father, for this time of reflection before us on your word, we invite you to be at work in our hearts. And as we prepare our hearts to receive from your word today, we would just stop to consider the incredible cost and the incredible gift that Easter represents in our lives. That there's no night so dark that the light of Christ cannot penetrate to dispel it. That there's no pit so deep that the Lord cannot descend all the way to lift us out of it. That there's no obstacle so high that Jesus is not higher still and able to take us over it. That there's no place where we can wander or to which we can run that's too far away for the King of the universe to seek us and find us, to bring us safely home. With Christ, in Christ, and through Christ, there's always hope. For if the grave could not hold him and death could not defeat him, then nothing is impossible for him. This same Christ who offers his sure and certain hope to all of us is with us in this place today. He'll be with us everywhere and always, even as we go about our daily lives. And this truly is good news. And so we say, Alleluia. Praise be to God. Amen. As we begin this morning, I want to invite you to turn in your Bible, if you have it with you. Open your phone, get out that Bible app. Luke chapter 24. That's where we're going to spend some time today. Luke chapter 24. And I want to start this morning by reading that for us. A familiar passage, I'm sure, but one that reminds us of what took place on this day so long ago. Luke 24, beginning at verse 1. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood before them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. Did Jesus really rise from the dead? The evidence for Jesus' resurrection is so strong that nobody would question it except for two things. First, it's a very unusual event. And secondly, if you happen to believe that it happened, then you have to change the way you live. The resurrection was inconceivable for the first disciples, as impossible for them to believe as it is for many people today. Granted, their reasons would have been different from ours. You see, the Greeks and the civilization of that time did not believe in resurrection. In the Greek worldview, the afterlife was the liberation of the soul from the body. For them, resurrection was never going to be part of life after death. As for the Jews, well, some of them believed in a future general resurrection when the entire world would be renewed, but they had no concept of an individual rising from the dead. The people of Jesus' day were not predisposed to believe in the resurrection any more than people in our day are. It was the 20th century American physicist Howard Aiken who once said, "Don't worry about people stealing your ideas. If your ideas are any good, you'll have to ram them down people's throats." Now that's a bit crude, but it gets the point across. As an early pioneer in the world of computers, I can imagine the numerous times that Aiken tried to explain what he did to those yet to discover the amazing power of the personal computer. And yet now each one of us interacts with a computer pretty much every day. I'm wearing a computer on my wrist. I have another computer right here in my pocket, as I'm sure some of you do. Likely the vehicle that you came in here this morning had a computer in it that enabled you to get here, that controlled the engine of that car. If you went to the grocery store to buy some hot cross buns for Easter, the checkout counter likely had a computer that processed the transaction. And if you're watching this from home, you're likely either on a computer or your phone or on a smart television that is itself a computer. Can you imagine, however, a time that existed before all these computers and have someone say, this is what the world is going to be like? I'm sure no one could have imagined just how involved we are with computers. I sometimes wonder, what's the world going to be like for my grandchildren? I mean, how do you get better than an iPhone? What's going to be out there 20 or 30 years from now that would have me saying, "Oh, I just don't know. I just can't wrap my mind around it." I'm sure there'll be something. Maybe they'll be beaming us from here to our vacation destinations in a matter of seconds. I don't know. The world is always changing. All that to say that Jesus' resurrection was shocking. It was unbelievable. It was impossible to wrap their minds around, even though Jesus had spent lots of time telling them that that was exactly what was going to happen. Of course, this passage that we just read is about a different kind of revolution, not a computer revolution, but one that was slow to be understood even by Jesus' closest followers. This lack of understanding, this seeming incomprehensibility, describes well the reactions of the first witnesses to the empty tomb. First, a group of women, and then the disciples. You know, even after being told directly by Jesus, the angels in this text essentially quote Matthew 16, verse 21, where Jesus directly tells them what's going to happen and gives specific instructions. even after being told directly by him, they remain confused and perhaps even a bit incredulous at the sight of the empty tomb. Can you imagine going to that tomb that morning, feeling like the worst has happened and you don't understand how the Messiah, the one that you'd placed your hope in, was gone, and you're grieving, and together you're supporting one another as you go with the spices to anoint the body of the one that you loved so much, only to find that he wasn't there. They're in shock. I know one of the largest gaps that exists between us postmodern people and the ancient world is the seemingly pervasive gap in both the belief and experience of the supernatural. We might assume that these women or the disciples would instantly believe that Jesus had risen from the dead the moment they saw him, or even when they heard another eyewitness testimony, but Luke 24 provides quite a different picture. They, like us, shared some doubts, some uncertainties, that someone that they had seen die just a few days earlier could actually be alive. In some ways, their skepticism seems on the verge of credibility. How could they have doubted, as the angels in the text make clear, when Jesus had already said this was exactly what was going to happen? Why was an empty tomb so disorienting to these faithful women who had come to prepare Jesus' body for burial? Well, the idea that Jesus would die, would not only die, remember how Peter responded when Jesus made the announcement that he was going to die? And Peter was like, no, this can't happen. Well, that idea that he would not only die but rise again was clearly outside the realm of the ordinary for Jesus' followers. And no matter how many times Jesus said it, the idea that the Messiah, the anointed one of Israel, the one who was supposed to kick out their foreign oppressors and set them free to restore the Davidic kingdom, would not only die but then be raised again 3 days later was simply too much to take in. In effect, something this new and revolutionary would have to be right there in front of them in order for them to believe. With that said, let's take a further look at what takes place when the women arrive at the tomb. There's a number of interesting points to be made about the fact that it was women who first found out about the resurrection of Jesus. It was women that went to the tomb, and this is significant. Women in that day, in the time of Christ, women were considered unreliable witnesses in that culture. They couldn't even testify in a court of law because you couldn't trust the word of a woman. Ironically, that's why modern-day apologists are certain that the resurrection really did occur. You see, if you were trying to, you know, do some kind of a cover-up, you were trying to mislead people, you were trying to influence people a certain way, you would design this whole story very differently. You wouldn't choose the most unreliable witnesses to testify to the truth. You would have chosen the most reliable witnesses. You would have written that it was the priests that went to the tomb, or it was some of the important men of the community that went to the tomb. If the early followers of Christ were worried about covering up certain details regarding the historical accuracy of Jesus' resurrection, they wouldn't have shared that it was a group of women that were first to experience the empty tomb. They would have left that detail out. Yet it seems to be significant to God. It seems to be significant that God in his providence chose women to be present at the tomb on the third day. They, like the rest of the disciples, were genuinely surprised both by the state of the emptiness of the tomb and by the appearance of two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning. Now, it's interesting that the writer of the Gospel of Luke doesn't use the word, the Greek word typically used here for a messenger from God, angelos, angels. But we can deduce from the passage, without question, that these are not ordinary men. These are angelic beings who had undoubtedly the greatest message ever given to humanity. The angels declare, he is not here, he has risen. You know, isn't that the cornerstone for all that we believe? The earliest churches in Greece and around the Mediterranean adapted these exact words in a liturgical formula that I think many of us are aware of. We use them at the beginning of the service. In Greek, Christos Anesti, which means Christ is risen, and is typically followed by Alithos Anesti, he is risen indeed. In these words lie the very heart of the Christian faith. And Paul makes that clear to us in his first letter to the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 16 and 17. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. You see, Christ's resurrection is the historical foundation for all that we as Christians believe. Luke tells us that after the angels paraphrased Jesus, the women remembered his words. Again, this sounds odd to us, but you have to admit that Jesus' teaching often is, in general, is quite cryptic. He spoke in parables, and we know from various gospel accounts that the disciples themselves really didn't understand the heart of the gospel. Even after they had experienced his death, it wasn't until his resurrection that it all started to make sense. In so many ways, remembering is crucial to the Christian faith for all of us. When we remember what God has said, when we remember what God has done for us in Jesus, there's the potential for transformation, for life change. Perhaps you find yourself in a struggle at work with a feeling that your employer doesn't perhaps perceive your true value, or people don't see all that you do. You feel somewhat invisible. Or perhaps just throughout this whole COVID time, it just seems like life has been difficult. You've been shut away. You've been removed from others. And you find yourself focusing on your circumstances, focusing on what's wrong with your life, focusing on perceived slights and dealing with difficult people. But why are you focusing so completely on your circumstances when the God of the universe, the Creator God, has chosen you to be his child, his beloved, in whom he is well pleased? My friend, focus on who you are in Christ instead of worrying about who you are to others. Focus on your relationship with God first, and everything else will be given to you. It's an early and easy lesson to miss, but one that you and I need constant reminders of. Interestingly enough, as we set our gaze first on Christ, it results in a completely different experience in work, at church, in community, in relationships, in our families. When we focus first on our relationship with Christ, it frees us up to give freely to others, to give unselfishly, to love without measure, without keeping score. That's described for us in 1 Corinthians 13. And when we do so, we end up serving and loving our colleagues better. We end up serving and loving our families better. We end up being better neighbors. We end up being better friends. How can we remember the words of Jesus in such a way that we live a life of faith and hope and love, lives that make a difference? Well, certainly it begins with the reminder that the God of the universe loves us so much that he was willing to send his son to die on a Roman cross as a criminal. He loves us that much, and our worth, our vision ought to be centered firmly on Christ. When it comes down to it, Luke chapter 24, verses 1 to 12, is a passage about the unexpected, the greatest surprise perhaps the world has ever known, that a Messiah, who at first was believed to be a political revolutionary, was actually enacting a very different kind of revolution, which enters a new phase of its development with the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And this revolution was almost incomprehensible, even to those who had dedicated their lives to following Jesus. The women's incredulousness, the disciples after them, is perhaps a metaphor for us all. Do we believe that resurrection is possible in our own lives? Do we believe that God can and will heal us and transform us more and more into his image? If so, then this text that we looked at this morning is an excellent reminder of Paul's words in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
And let's stand together and sing a closing song this morning.
My redeemer lives. My redeemer.
Thank you for being here with us and sharing in this service together with us today. Happy Easter to you all. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.